speculation has been replacing hard fact.
Terrorists don't read Twitter.
Who's right and who's wrong?
It was a terrible thing to say, period.
The mistake entirely on me.
What we need is to question more and to keep it uncensored, real and raw. These words are hard hitting, you're watching your neck, but you need to tune in because what is said.
What's happening, y'all? I'm Abby Martin, and this is the very last episode of Breaking the Set. And this being our last show, I am so pleased to see an enormous victory for one of the issues I care most about, net neutrality. After months of uncertainty, yesterday the Federal Communications Commission, or FCC, voted to uphold a free and open internet for all by classifying the technology as a utility. Essentially, it means that broadband providers like Verizon and Comcast won't be able to speed up or slow down web traffic based on who can pay more money, completely redefining the internet as we know it. It's not only an enormous triumph for free speech, but for the power of grassroots activism. See, this was no easy feat. Telecoms lobbied Congress with hordes of cash to establish a pay-to-play business model, and Obama even appointed a former telecom lobbyist to head the FCC. But as people began to wake up to the importance of this issue, the agency was flooded with a record 4 million comments, the vast majority pleading to uphold net neutrality. Activists even went to Wheeler's home, preventing him from going to work until he answered whether he was working for the almighty telecoms or the people. Look, it's clear that the Comcasts and Verizons of the world aren't going to give up that easily, and no doubt will draw out this battle in months in the courts. But for now, it's victories like these that prove the power of the people can be greater than the corporatocracy. So on that note, for one last time, let's break the set. Over the course of this show, there's one guest that has consistently shed a brilliant light on every topic I've thrown at him. From the prison industrial complex to immigration, Eugene Puryear has fought for social justice in every way imaginable and is one of the most visible and hardworking activists in the country, let alone here in Washington. This past election, he also ran for DC City Council as a member of the Green Party, earning him more than 12,000 votes in the process. And this being our final show, I wanted to get his insight one last time on how to channel all the pent-up frustration and anger over the state of our current political system into tangible change. He joined me earlier, and I first asked him what effective activism looks like.
Well, I think the difference between what's effective and what's not effective isn't necessarily, well, did you reach XYZ goal this year, but are you able to move the goalpost, as it were, in terms of bringing new people into your cause? I mean, I think when we look at the history of social movements, it's up and down in terms of victories. But what you sort of see, or at least see retrospectively in history, is that there is really sort of a steady momentum in the growth of organizations and institutions. And so I think since a lot of the issues we work on can be quick or sort of fleeting and things that we didn't necessarily initiate but are responding to, the importance is really how do we mark time in terms of building institutions, building organizations, and really empowering people to create change. Because it's really that continuum that when you look back is the clear sort of growth, not the particular events that took place.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think a lot of people want to get involved in these issues, ranging from police brutality to ending the prison industrial complex, yet they're just so overwhelmed due to the sheer scope of how many issues are just simply too daunting. What is your advice to even get started?
Mm-hmm. Well, my first piece of advice I would say is that you don't have to be like a super person to become an activist. I think a lot of people are concerned that not only are there so many issues, but they only have but so much time. I always say if you're really organized, even if you can only give me 30 minutes every week, we can find a way to make that important. So the first thing I would say is figure out what you realistically can do. And then once you know what you realistically can do, start with organizations or looking for organizations on just pick one issue that you're most passionate about, because so many of these issues are also interconnected. It'll come back around. Pick something, anything that you're passionate about, look for organizations, hopefully find them, let them know what you can do, and let them slot you in. Now, if you can't find someone who's working on what you want to do, do it yourself. I mean, I think for a lot of people that seems very daunting, but organizing basically comes down to having a goal, figuring out what you need to do to get to that goal, and doing it. So it's a lot of trying to find people who are just like you on social media, in the streets, handing stuff out, knocking on doors, all really basic level stuff that a lot of people already kind of know that activists and organizers do, but figuring out what you can do sustainably, because it is really a long distance run, not a sprint. And so it's important to really, before you do anything else, I think if you want to get involved, figure out what you can really commit and then start moving. So that way, even if it's a small amount of time, you use it really well.
Right. I like that you said that everything's really interconnected, because I always tell people, pick the issue that you are most passionate about. Figure out who's doing things around your area with that one issue, and if they're not, go into meetup.com, start an independent website, a blog, so you can start to galvanize people around a hub, and then go for it. And you'd be surprised at how many like minds there really are, mm-hmm. maybe around you that you don't know, and really starting to get energized and talking to people who are also activists or concerned about those issues gets you motivated to do more. You ran for DC City Council mm-hmm. this past election, received thousands of votes, which was pretty amazing for a first run here. I mean, but the odds are so greatly stacked against third-party candidates, even at a local level here. What did you learn from the campaign about competing with this two-party dictatorship that has a stranglehold on our process?
Well, what I learned is that, you know, people power is more powerful than you'd think. I mean, we were probably close to last on the money list, but we beat several people who had tens of thousands more dollars than us, including the guy with the most money, because we were able to mobilize large numbers of people. Now, you need lots of people. You know, we had hundreds of volunteers mm-hmm. during the course of the campaign, which, believe it or not, is actually very rare, even for these big campaigns. They just spend money. And so what I learned is that really, when you have a lot of like-minded people who are working together in concert on an issue or issues that they really care about, you can breach this power structure. And I think that's important, because even outside of politics, the big media, the big corporations, I mean, it seems as if they have so much power, but the money and the power that they have is still concentrated in a very small number of people, and you can isolate them much more easily than you think. And that's kind of what I learned in this election. I knew it a little bit, but I learned it very viscerally here, is that the power of the people really can inject itself into the conversation. Even if you don't win, you can force yourself into the conversation if you're able to organize effectively.
It just seems like conservatives and the right wing are so lockstep and uniform in their ideals, and they push it out there just unabashedly, you know, fascist at times. And the left is so disjointed. It seems like that's the biggest problem that I see, is the splintering, when everyone can really get behind these core issues. How do we kind of get these core issues to the forefront so the left can really organize behind them, get some tangible change on the ground?
Mm-hmm. Well, I think what it is recognizing the amount of unity that's possible and then maximizing uh-huh. that. Like, on every issue, you never know who you're going to be able to bring together. But I think what we've seen, for example, in the Black Lives Matter movement, is that it was such a huge, massive uprising of people that so many groups and individuals and organizations started working together who either didn't know each other or didn't like each other before, because the moment sort of overwhelmed them. And I think when you have clear goals, you can really start to bring larger peoples together. And when you bring people together on limited campaigns, what you really start to do that also helps bring more people together is you build trust, you build understanding, people start to understand where different people are coming from, and then ultimately allows you to build a broader unity on a broader set mm-hmm. of issues, a wider set of issues.
Mm-hmm. And I know that you've been involved in the Black Lives Matter movement, in particular here in D.C., the Ferguson stuff. What tactics? I know tactics are a tricky conversation, of course. I'm not going to sit there as a white privileged woman and be like, hey, this is what people should be doing in the Black Lives Matter movement. But I mean, just in terms of police reform, obviously you've written an entire book about the prison industrial complex as well. How are these issues correlated together? And also, what tactics have you seen that actually work to affect tangible change to reform that whole system?
Mm-hmm. Well, I think the things are so connected together. I mean, we have to look at it as sort of a military police, militarized police complex all across yeah. of it. I mean, you have this set of laws that is really there to contain social problems created in communities that have been economically hollowed out, and it starts with the police on the street, and it ends with the not just the prison, but the post-prison life, where you're sort of put in second-class citizenship for the rest of your life, oftentimes, for a lot of people. And I think the thing that was so effective for us in D.C. Ferguson and with Black Lives Matter in general was direct action. I mean, that was something mm-hmm. that we had gotten away from, but unplanned, forceful, direct action that slowed down the main arteries, the highways that went into the sports games, just anywhere and everywhere where it was able to stop business as usual. And I feel that there's an array of tactics that exist, but for sure, when you have an issue that, like the police brutality issue, the prison issue, oftentimes is deep in the background and no politician wants to put it forward, you have to use those direct action type tactics. And I think what we've also seen is that you have to follow that up with tangible outreach goals to reach the people who saw what you did and loved it. And here in D.C., with the D.C. Ferguson, for example, we started a petition against a form of racially biased policing, where now we've gathered thousands upon thousands of names of people who are like, yes, what they're doing is right, what's happening in Ferguson is wrong, this racism and police brutality is terrible. And we went to them and said, hey, it's happening right here in D.C., so you can actually do something. You don't just have to cheer us on from the sidelines. And we brought in a whole new range of people who might not have even been out there protesting but saw us and liked it. So inject yourself into the conversation, but then immediately realize that as quickly as you get in the conversation, you can fall out. But the easiest way to keep yourself in the game and to do something effectively is to expand your numbers.
Thank you so much. Eugene Perrier, organizer with the Answer Coalition, author of Shackled and Chained. Really appreciate you coming on the show. You've been my favorite guest, and I just love you, man.
No, well, I love to be here, and I love everything you do. So thank you so much, and all the Breaking the Set viewers that have been so good to me over the years.
Thank you so much, Eugene. You're the best. Coming up, we'll take a look at some of the best moments we've ever had on the show. And don't forget that all of our episodes will still be archived on our YouTube channel, youtube.com/breakingthesset. And as always, don't forget to follow me on Twitter at Abby Martin, because I'm not dying and will still be producing daily news.
You know that guy who wishes someone would spy on him? How about the woman who enjoys being lied to by her government? This citizen can't get enough congressional inaction. And this taxpayer wants the mainstream media to be more corporatized. While this person would rather eat genetically modified food, this one thinks our prisons are not crowded enough. And what do these people have in common? They don't exist.
Over the course of this show, I've had the great honor of sitting down with truly fascinating people, from philosopher Noam Chomsky to filmmaker Oliver Stone. As such, it's been quite difficult to boil down some of my favorite interviews, but join me now to look back at some of the most memorable exchanges to take place as a result of the show. I'm joined by Breaking the Set producer, Anya Ferrampel. I just said your name wrong again. Anya, one of the most ridiculous moments, I think, so far on the show was Nestle. The weird automaton woman replicant, Stephanie from Nestle, who actually made us a video response to one of our reports. Let's take a look.
Let's watch it.
Hello, Abby. I'm Stephanie from Nestle. We saw the video you posted on YouTube criticizing Nestle over water. You claimed we take water during droughts in Canada. In fact, we've always reduced our water use during droughts and will continue to do so.
The most bizarre thing
I've
ever
seen. I know, right?
Seen.
And we know that that's just preposterous, considering last year, even after she sent that message, we were reporting on the fact that, oh, drought in California, I guess Nestle's there pulling water out of an Indian reservation. It's just a lie. I mean,
right.
Nestle owns about 50 water brands worldwide. You really can't escape them, and then that's how they do it, by just sucking up water
everywhere. A lot of people think of them just as, you know, the chocolate slave labor in the Ivory Coast, but really the water extraction for pennies on the dollar. They literally suck up water and will package it in just, you know, toxic plastic and then just sell it back to communities.
Poland Springs to San Pellegrino to Perrier.
To Perrier.
You can't escape
Inescapable
Nestle.
Or Stephanie. That weird, it was just the weirdest thing ever. And of course, Nestle's not the only company we've taken down on this show. We've gone after Monsanto, BP. We actually went to visit the BP headquarters in Nolens when we were there. Let's check out what happened. We're just wondering if someone could talk to the press. It's a representative from BP.
In regards to
a lot of things that are going on here. Okay. So you guys have no one at all that can talk to anyone.
Sir, can you turn it up, or can you leave the building, please?
So, Abby, I was part of the team that stayed behind in D.C., and after you paid this little visit to BP in New Orleans, they called us in the office and were like, hey, you know, we were just visited by your host, Abby Martin. We looked at her Twitter afterwards, and we're really concerned she's not going to be covering us fairly, judging from her tweets, because apparently your job is to cover BP fairly.
Yeah, BP fairly, the company that sprayed toxic corexit in the ocean and, you know, poisoned thousands of people and isn't paying out the claims. Yeah, they're a really great company. Yeah. Sorry, BP, didn't cut it very fairly.
I mean, it's all fair statements, right? So they
absolutely
can't argue with it.
And, you know, this exemplifies exactly what I was trying to tell Piers Morgan when I went, when I had the great honor of going on CNN in the aftermath of the Crimea hysteria, when he told me, I don't self-censor. Let's take a listen.
Let's see.
Why do I have to work for RT to tell the truth about corporations and the U.S. government? I mean, seriously, you guys are beholden to advertisers that you cannot criticize, and that's why I work for a station that I can criticize.
Well, I'm free to say what the hell I like.
Sure. I'm free to say whatever I like. The thing is, he's not realizing how insane that comment is, because that's precisely why CNN hired him, so he doesn't criticize their advertisers.
This is the network of Don Lemon, Abby. These are the people they hire because they don't even realize, oh, maybe I'm not asking that question because they don't think of the question they're supposed to ask.
BP is one of the thousands of corporate sponsors and advertisers on the corporate media, and it's just, like, outrageous that these people just don't understand that they are the tools.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? They are the tools of the corporate media. And they're self-censoring all the time.
Absolutely.
But really not being cognizant of that. One of the greatest moments, I think, I don't know why the hell they let me in Guantanamo Bay, but they did. They won't let me back, that's for sure. But it was amazing to talk to these Army personnel there, especially Captain Gressback, about the hunger strike going on. Let's take a listen to what he actually called this.
The word hunger strike, again, does not accurately portray what their motivation is, and so it was determined quite some time ago to call it a non-religious fasting.
Yeah, I mean, it's amazing. He's calling a hunger strike a long-term non-religious fast.
I mean, it's just ridiculous, but a very important issue that we covered on the show. You know, 122 men still in prison there as of January, according to the ACLU, 54 of which have already been cleared for release. I mean, it's ridiculous to think that these men there don't have any grievances worth expressing.
We don't know why they're striking, so we're just going to call them a long-term non-religious fast. Just like all this jargon that means absolutely nothing. But of course, when it comes to issues we've covered the most on the show that really no other network has the balls to is Israel, and it's just continuous military offenses against the largest open-air prison in the world, which actually isn't saying much for a prison, because prisons don't turn off their water and electricity randomly for the inmates. So, you know, I had the chance to actually interview a spokesperson for Netanyahu
two years ago
during the first Operation Pillar of Cloud, I think it was called, when they actually deliberately bombed a journalist tower in Gaza that housed
RT.
Let's take a listen to what he had to say.
You personally are invited to come to Israel. Believe me, you will be the best guest in Israel. Come and see what we have suffered from for all these years.
Yeah, let's see what the Israelis have been suffering from all these years. I'm sure that's what you would find if you took him up on his offer to go to Israel. Or maybe you would find that, according to a new study from Oxfam, it would take 100 years to rebuild the damage that Israel has brought on the country over the years, especially considering the blockade that doesn't allow construction materials in. I mean, I don't know if that's what you would find or something that Mr. Israeli spokesperson would be proud of.
Yeah, and he ended up saying, like, just the most ridiculous stuff. He was like, come to Israel, we welcome you, really? I'm sure I'll be welcome with open arms in Israel. I mean, they just banned that Norwegian doctor from coming in, who's just been helping Gazans for the last, decade, and now he can't even get in to help people. I mean, it's just unbelievable. But you know what? I am going to take you up on your offer. I am coming to Israel and coming to Gaza, so I'll be seeing you, Mr. Spokesperson, and we'll see if you hold your promise true.
Be a guest of honor, I'm sure.
Thank you so much. I love you, Anya.
Oh,
you've
been
amazing.
It's been such a pleasure, Abby.
Thank you so much. It's hard to sum up 3 years of daily shows into just one montage, especially with so many ridiculous, hilarious, and infuriating moments. But here are some of our favorites from the past 534 episodes. I'm your host, Abby Martin, and this is Breaking the Set, My producer and I just got back from Haiti, the Pine Ridge Reservation in South Dakota, Guantanamo Bay prison in Cuba. We traveled down to New Orleans, Louisiana, Detroit, Michigan, to visit Cuba. F the media, f the candidates, f the corporatocracy. Walmart's also been described as an economic death star, destroying everything in its path, leaving behind nothing more than a homogenous wasteland. Monsanto cannot be trusted. It's time that we as consumers become conscious and critical thinkers.
Hello, Abby. I'm Stephanie from Nestle.
After 9/11, the U.S. was given a huge opportunity to embark on a new era of unity and partnership with the world. But instead, the government exploited the tragedy, not only to erode American civil liberties, but also to engage in endless militarism based on imperial bloodlust.
We reserve the right to act unilaterally, as we have done relentlessly since I took office, to take out terrorists who pose a direct threat to us and our allies.
Yeah! Unilateral, aggressive, relentless bombing, America! Isn't it so exciting to usher in and fawn over a known war criminal? Once you peel back the layers, Hillary Clinton is not just a mere wolf in sheep's clothing. She's an unabashed hawk, through and through. Thank you, John, for sharing what a racist, scumbag war criminal you are with millions of people. Remind me again why it is that people are worshiping kings and queens in the year 2013. Obama is officially the drone king. He's ramped up the use of these unmanned killer robots dramatically since taking office.
I think whistleblowers are admired. I never cracked down. I never heard of a crackdown on whistleblowers.
Right now?
Why are we who's cracking down on whistleblowers?
Obama. He's already charged. Snowden's the eighth person charged under the Espionage Act. I totally disagree that he was the most progressive president that we've had. The coverage I've seen of Ukraine has been truly disappointing from all sides of the media spectrum and rife with disinformation. If the investigation finds that this missile was indeed Russian, then it exemplifies exactly why state power should not be providing high-grade weaponry to militias. Listen, criticisms of Russia's actions are valid, but the Foreign Policy Initiative and the stooges that do its bidding represent corrupt and dark forces that don't care about a free media, diplomacy, peace, and certainly not human rights. It's not a fight between Islam and the West. It's a fight between the most extreme and militarized ideologues on all sides.
90% of these terrorist attacks are not committed by Christians, not committed by Muslims, not committed by Jews, not committed by people of any religion. They're committed by men.
I'm sick of my Palestinian friends losing their friends and family every time Israel goes on the offense against innocent people living in an open-air prison.
Whether your expression of dissatisfaction, desire for change, is an email, a letter to your congressman carrying a picket sign, being a blockade in front of a Coca-Cola ramp or a railroad line shipping weapons, find a weapon and fire it.
Ashes to ashes, dust to dust. So rest in peace, Michael C. Rupert. Your insight and passion will be truly, truly missed. The fight can be won by extending empathy globally. And that means being the change we want to see. Because at the end of the day, that's all we can ever do.
If we are going to leave this planet in any kind of a habitable form for our children and our grandchildren, we're going to have to begin to make massive sacrifices now to carry out massive acts of civil disobedience. Because if we trust within the system, it'll kill us.
The structures we've created oftentimes imprison us from each other and the natural world. It's so easy to forget the bigger picture. And it's so easy to forget that we're one human family living on one organism. Wow. What to say after three amazing years. Hosting this show has been the most invaluable, rewarding experience of my life. I came to DC as an activist and citizen journalist with a little website called Media Roots. And then I was given an international platform to be myself. Growing so much in the process as both a person and a journalist. We've tried to present issues here in an unfiltered and out-of-the-box way, while bringing alternative voices to the forefront through the likes of independent musicians, grassroots activists, and prolific journalists. Over the course of this show, I've been most rewarded out in the field, from Gitmo to Detroit, getting to the heart of the story and speaking to people on the ground. There's only so much that can be done confined to a studio, and I'm excited to leap into the unknown and follow my heart. So stay tuned.
Breaking the Set has been the most hard-hitting show on television by far. Every single episode was packed with more information than you'd get from an entire year of watching CNN, as well as carried a punch to the gut of all the neocons, war propagandists, and lackey stenographers. But never in a million years could I have imagined the amazing support this kind of show would generate, proving just how many people are hungry out there for systemic change and raw truth delivered from someone who's not a plastic automaton. Which is great, because I just can't report the horrors I immerse myself with on a daily basis any other way. It's been an amazing and a long, sometimes hard road. I've lost some along the way, but I gained more than I ever thought I could. It's been an incredible run that wouldn't have been possible without your support. So thank you. I told myself I wouldn't cry, but here I am. But all good things must come to an end, because impermanence is an inescapable human condition. Life is suffering, and a resistance to change is the root of this pain. The river at one moment is not the same as the river in the next, and it never will be, and that's okay. Life is constant change and growth, and we need to embrace that. Even on a cellular level, if you're not changing, you're not growing. Humility is key. Every day we need to take on the world understanding how much we still don't know. We need to open our minds and our hearts to put ourselves in other people's shoes. We need to listen to each other and shout from the rooftops, I'm mad as hell and I'm not gonna take it anymore. Allow ourselves to laugh at how insane the world can be and cry. Call your parents and tell them you love them. Take the time to smile, extend a hand, paint, photograph, and sing at the top of your lungs. And most importantly, love each other. Remember that nations are invented, borders are invisible, prejudice is learned. We're all human beings who bleed the same blood and shed the same tears. Every time a person suffers from Detroit to Gaza, that's our brother, that's our sister, that's our family. Yes, the problems of the world are daunting. And yes, suffering is inescapable, but there's so much breathtaking beauty on the planet that needs to be honored too. But to truly appreciate the good, we first must free ourselves from the prisons of our own minds and the dogma society ingrains in us. Our empathy needs to extend toward every corner of the earth, to every living thing. Look, I struggle with all of this on a daily basis as I've delved into the utter destruction wrought on this precious planet. But I also know that every issue I've ever covered is so much bigger than me and my tiny existence. I have only been a vessel for the truth, and now you all need to be too. So empower yourself, and please know you're not alone, because together we'll never, ever stop breaking the set.